Okay. Now, Dazzle is kind of really easy to play. That's one thing for
True.
sure, because all you are the only time you're gonna fail as a Dazzle is when you have bad positioning. Positioning is key when it comes to Dazzle. I feel like in Dazzle's gameplay, the only thing you need to worry about is positioning. There's literally almost nothing else that you need to worry about when you're playing Dazzle. In a team fight, in regular skirmishes, everything. You will not die as Dazzle unless you get out of position. Now,
Yes.
playing Dazzle also means positioning also means you have the right information on the map, right? So what I mean by that is if you have no vision on the map and your team is pushing, you could be behind your team, but you still might get picked off because you didn't ward up properly. Or
Yes.
if there's a Ricky or something, he'll just jump on you and he'll kill you because there was no sentries or something like that. So you need to really secure your positioning when you play Dazzle, and most supports are very much like that. You really rely heavily on positioning in most supports. There are some supports, as I mentioned, some of them were like leech, some of them like ogre. They really don't care about positioning too much. They've got plenty of stuff, but you can get away with a lot of silly stuff when you play those heroes. Now, your item build was fine almost. Let's go back. Did I go back or did I? What the hell did I do? Okay. When you are picking, so you're obviously going to buy a courier, you're going to buy two wards.
I
You
was
bought only.
going to give one of them to Undying, but he suddenly bought the other one, so I was just like with no wards for the 5 minutes. Like,
No, he
for
didn't
the
buy a ward.
after this he did. I buy the first one, then give it to our offlaner, then I buy the other one. That's like how I'm used to it. And then he suddenly bought the other ward in a second. So I was like with no ward after
Okay.
it.
So what I would have done instead of what you did here right now, you have to understand firstly that your heal, this one right here, you are using up 90 mana to do exactly 80 heal at level
Yes.
one, right? We're gonna only talk about level one at the moment. You're doing 90, you're using 90 mana to do 80 heal. Now, let's talk about four tangos, right? Four tangos will give you approximately 445, 450 HP, right?
Yes.
So 450 HP is how many heals at level one?
It's almost six of them.
It's almost six of them, right?
Think.
450 divided by 80. Yeah, almost six of them. So it's less than six of them, but it's let's say six of them, right? So if
Yeah.
it's six of them, then if you use it six times, you use 90 mana. 9 6 are
540 mana.
540 mana, exactly. 540 mana. One clarity gives you about 200 mana, right? So you would approximately need less than three clarities to get the same amount of health, right? Three
Yes.
clarities is 150 gold,
Yeah.
right? Now, keep one thing in mind that you're actually getting more health back. Because this is 450 and three of these is more than that, right?
Yeah.
Six heals is six eights are six are 40, 480. So slightly more than no, slightly more. But also for one so 150 gold, you're taking 150 gold to do the same amount of health to yourself, whereas a tango costs two of 125, right? So just 25
Yeah,
less gold. So
true.
for 25 less gold, you're doing almost the same amount. So 25 more gold, you're doing almost the same amount of health, but this health is firstly instant. Secondly, you're also healing your teammate with this. So it's
Yeah,
almost double the value.
I see.
Point being that you get more from you get more from the clarity than you get from the tango. That's one
I
thing
see.
that I wanted to point out. Second thing, and also yeah, second thing is that you really need this item when you start the game. You really need a windlace.
I
Like
see.
most of the times, unless there is an invis hero in the game, and you have no other support who's going to buy sentries, and you are literally stuck with buying two sets of observers, two sets of tangos, and a courier, unless that sort of a really sad situation happens, you should always start off with a windlace, right?
Excellent.
Now let me go over the gold here, right? So windlace is 225 gold, plus you're going to buy 65 for two observers, plus 100 for a courier. You're left with 455 gold, plus you're going to buy two clarities, and now you've got 555 gold, right? And you still have 70 gold left over. What you can do is you can buy either three clarities, right? Or if you really, really must, then it depends. Like, if you've got a dual offlane situation, then it's tough. It's something that you probably want to experiment, whether you want to buy one clarity and a tango, or you still want to stick with three clarities, right? But tango is not really so crucial on Dazzle. It's not super crucial. All right. Moving on. Start those starting items. Actually, let me just go over really quickly. What if we do start off with sentries? So you get two sentries plus two wards. Yeah, so you've got 430 gold. And you've got literally 195 left over. Yeah, so you have pretty much no choice. You have to buy. Oof. You have to. You can then probably buy three clarities again, and you literally end up with nothing in your inventory except three clarities. So that'll be, that is super rough.
Yeah.
That is super, super rough. But, you know, that's solo supporting, and what are you going to do? Actually, it's almost worth not even bothering with buying sentries at 0-0 minutes when there is an invis hero, because, like, usually in your bracket, invis heroes aren't gonna, like, if it's a Ricky or a bounty hunter, he's not gonna pressure the mid lane so much. He's gonna try and get his levels, etc. So it's not gonna be too bad. All right, moving onwards. Where's your wards? Oh, he's got both wards.
Yeah, so I gave him one, and then he bought the other one at the exact same time, as I said. Yeah.
So what did you? Oh, you bought another tango then.
Our mid laner needed two tangos, but I figured he'd need more and more. So I thought if I have to rotate, I can just give him more. So it would be better to have some.
I don't think that was a good idea. I think it would have been much better if you had, not bought any tangos at all, as we already discussed. But if you really needed to give the mid laner tangos and you were stuck with buying tangos just so you can give the mid laner tangos, you usually need to, right? Tell the mid laner from the beginning, I'm not going to give you tangos, right? Buy your own bloody tangos. It's not, I don't know why the hell these guys are even bothering with this. See, this is the problem with watching pro games. They watch pro games and then they think, oh, we need, you know, we need a fairy fire and a ironwood branch to start off with because, oh, it makes us so good. And then they take 10,000 worth of harass, and then they're like, oh, shit, we don't have any regen. The only reason why pro players go for that build is because they know guaranteed they're not going to take harass. Like, if they feel like we are going to take harass, if there's a Ricky in the game or something like that, or a roaming hero, they rarely go for that build. They will go for a tango because they know they'll need more regen. In fact, they'll even get a self bot brought out to them. In fact, usually they will, even if they have started with a fairy fire, they'll still bring a self to them because they know that they need more regen. And these guys start off with like no regen at all. This guy is smart, but I don't think he's smart. He's just, he's got a bottle start, so he's actually quite stupid. Anyway, not bothering with that. Yeah, so not having a ward, really, really big issue, because now whoever the offlaner is, you're not going to know where he is. You can go on my channel and have a really quick look at the warding video that I've made. It's got three levels, basic, intermediate, and advanced. Even if you see all the entire video through, even the advanced section, I highly advise not to do the advanced stuff, because your team is not going to benefit, you're not going to benefit. I've literally made that beginner, medium, and advanced just because keeping the MMR brackets in mind. So beginner is all the way up to 2K MMR. If you start warding too much, then your team is not going to, you're basically wasting your gold, totally wasting your gold. So stick with the basic level warding. You need to buy only like one ward every 2 to 3 minutes. Don't need to buy too many wards. You can have maximum of 2 wards at map at any given time. Right now, you really needed a ward over here. So if it's a solo offlaner, then you need a ward over here to keep an eye out on the solo offlaner and see where he is. And if it's a dual offlane, then you can actually just throw down a ward over here, your first ward over here, and just keep an eye out over here just to make sure that the offlaner is not rotating into the mid. The mid laner isn't coming over here, just to keep those things in mind. Second thing is that this is actually, you really should do either one of two things. Either your carry, so both you and your carry should split this thing between the two of you. One guy should block this wave all the way through. Obviously, I understand, like, in the 1K bracket, you guys are not going to be very good at blocking. That's not too big a deal. Just try. As long as you try, it's okay. And the second thing that you should do is you should go over here and stand over here, right? Actually, forget about that. There's both of you attempt to block it. So try blocking it, and it's really, really important you block it. And the reason why you want to block it, especially if it's a solo offlane, right? If it's a dual offlane, then blocking it really doesn't matter. But if it's a solo offlane, then what you are trying to achieve in this lane is you're trying to keep the wave over here as close to the tower, but not under the tower. Don't let the creeps get, enemy creeps be hit by the tower. Obviously, that's for the carry, not you so much. You want to keep the wave over here and, okay, let's see if the camera, here we go. Keep the wave over here. So the carry is farming over here. And then what you want to do is you want to try to move around from the back. Don't let the creeps aggro to you. Don't be in range of the creeps so they start hitting you and they move away. Rotate around and start hitting the offlaner. What you want to do is you want to keep the offlaner somewhere around here by right-clicking him constantly. And you want to keep the creep wave over here. By this method, what you can achieve is your carry is going to get free farm. You're going to get some levels from the lane split. Not a lot of XP, but a little XP. And the offlaner is completely going to get zoned out, and he's going to stay back, and he's going to be low levels higher up in the game. Like, your carry is going to be level 6, and that guy is maybe going to be level 3 or level 2 even. So you want to keep doing that. And as soon as you see the offlaner go back, then you want to come over here. You want to pull this, and then you want to join it with this one, or you want to stack this, and you want to pull it through. Now, this is something that you should always, always, always do, right? Stacking, pulling, all this stuff. Now, this is something you want to practice. If you're not good at it, practice. Go into a custom lobby, practice it as much as you possibly can. Practice stacking this camp and pulling it. Practice 53, you pull it to stack it, and 15 seconds, you pull it to join it with your creep wave. And if you want to pull through, then you pull this one at either 15 or 45. And then you, as soon as one creep dies, and there's going to be usually 3 creeps here, right? So one creep dies, you can take that last hit to get that gold. The second creep starts to die, you want to move over here. As soon as the second creep dies, you want to hit this one, and you want to start pulling it over. You don't need to cut the tree over here. You can just pull it right from the side there. This is something that you really need to practice. Now, you see what you've done wrong right off the bat from what I just explained to you. You're standing behind your carry right now. You should be going around and right-clicking this guy so that he moves back. Instead, you're standing over here. You're not achieving anything. What you're doing right here is you are actually leeching the XP and nothing else, right? So you don't want to be doing that. And instead, your carry is the one who's actually harassing that guy, and he's going to miss the last... He didn't miss last hit. Did he miss last hit? Nice. He's good. He's smart. He's a smart carry. So imagine if you'd been there as well at that time, right? You were harassing this guy as well. You had leveled up Poison Touch from the beginning instead of a Shadow Wave. Don't think this would have been a kill. 33%. It is 33% for 3 seconds. 33% means about 200 still movement speed. So 100 and... I think this could have been a kill, actually. I think this could have been a kill. If he's slowed for 33%, let's see what this guy has. It's horrible starting items, but he... I don't know. Could have been a close one. Could have been a kill. Could possibly have been a kill. Regardless, you leveled your Shadow Wave up. I'm not sure when you leveled it up, but you want to hold on to your skill points. Do you see when you get to the lane? If it's a dual offlane situation, then you're not gonna achieve anything with the Poison Touch. In fact, what you should do is you just completely avoid getting Poison Touch until you've got everything else maxed out. Right?
I see.
If it's a dual lane situation, because literally you're not gonna achieve anything on Poison Touch. But if it is offlane, what you want to achieve with Poison Touch is just harass, and especially harass on the offlane. Never put stats over Poison Touch anymore. It was a thing, not anymore. You always want to max out Poison Touch at the end, but you do want to max it out. You don't want to put stats. Did you actually? No.
No, I haven't.
I don't know why I thought. I don't know. Sorry. I have no idea why I thought you had put points in stats. Anyway, yes, good job. You stacked this, but you see, you could have gotten this stack off even if you had started off hitting, harassing Naga. If you'd thrown out a Poison Touch, you would have been back here in time to do this stack anyway. Looks like you're going to go in for the pull. That's excellent. Good job. You want to throw down a nuke? All right. That was a mistake right there. You need to know when these creeps are strong and when they are weak. When you have these ice, slow, snow thingy person,
yeah,
they are very, very strong. So what you want to do is you want to move over your body over here along with the creeps, because at level one you do four targets. So these are three.
Yes.
These are three. You want to maximize the damage by being there yourself. You want to move over close to them and then zap them once, right? Shadow wave them once. And that one time should be enough. Like, this guy's half HP right now. You should move over here and shadow wave once. And this would have been your level two. You would have cleared out this entire camp. You would have denied this whole creep wave of experience, and you would have gotten your level two from here guaranteed. But right now, you're not going to get your level two. It's literally going to be. Actually, you would have gotten your level two and a half, not just level two. You would have been level two and a half, less than 2 minutes in. So that would have been pretty damn good. But you actually ended up leeching XP from this carry in the lane to get your level two. That's pretty bad.
Yeah.
All right. So one more time. So you've got Grave and you've got a wave. Now, obviously Dazzle needs Grave, but based on the situation, how likely do you think you're going to need Grave in the next minute or two? Highly, highly unlikely, right? There's almost no way, right? So you didn't need to level this up at all. Again, you have a solo offlaner. You really should have leveled up your Poison Touch because you could have used it to harass the offlaner. Second thing here is that right here, if you'd started walking over to this lane, over to this small camp, you would have gotten there in time to stack it, because remember, there's some leftover ones. There's some creeps. There are three creeps exactly left over. You could have stacked them once again, and even though you're not taking the full wave of XP, you could have still denied this entire creep wave. Not only would you have denied this entire creep, sorry, not this one, the one that's going to spawn next, because you're going to stack this one right now, and then you're going to pull this one out. And then you would have actually also reset the wave, because as you can see, the wave is pushing in and Naga is going to get everything. So far, all you've done is you've denied one creep wave worth of experience to the Naga, and you've leased quite a fair bit. So right now, you're level 3, and this guy's also level 3. And this guy is, well, not sure how she is being zoned out. Oh, because in the early levels, she almost died because of the harass from the CK. But, oh, wait, no. She's going to get all this XP, and then she'll be the same as your CK, actually. I want to have a look at that afterwards. But right here, once again, what you could have done right now is you could have gone here, you could have pulled this one, and then you could have connected it to the big camp. But instead, you're here, you're leeching XP, you're not harassing the Naga, you're literally just leeching XP. That's all you're doing. The Nyes don't really give any, like, it's no big deal. At all.
True.
Hey, right click in the tower. Not sure why you're doing that. You're a support hero. You do 58 damage.
Yeah.
And after the tower's minus, after the tower's armor, you're probably doing 10 damage to the tower max. And not only that, but you took shit tons of damage from the tower that you have to take a eat tango. Like, if you play like this, that's when you need regen. But if you actually play smart and you don't play like this, you don't need regen. You only literally, you're going to be using Shadow Wave, literally only to either take out this camp once or just throw it onto your carry. And obviously, you're going to get free heal from that. So you really never need a tango at all. Radiant almost never. Second thing is, now you've leveled up Poison Touch, but you still haven't used it. I agree with your decision right now to pick a point in Poison Touch. What I don't agree with was putting a point in Grave. Right now, you should have had 1 point in Poison Touch and 2 points in Shadow Wave. And that would have been the best build right now. Because you don't need a Grave. There's no way anybody, unless you start diving towers like you were just now, unless you start doing things like that, you're not going to need Grave. And as long as you tell the carry, dude, I don't have Grave right now, I'm going to get Grave at level 4, and you know that you don't have Grave, don't play dangerously. That's it. You can get away with putting 2 points in Shadow Wave. You're doing more heal to both yourself and your carry. You're doing more damage to the small camp. You're taking it faster. You're doing more damage to, if this guy comes in close, you're doing more damage to this guy. So, see, what right now, all you did was 80 damage, right? But you could have done, sorry, not 80 damage, you did 160 damage, but you could have done 200 damage instead. This guy, instead of 140, he would have been at 100 HP right now. And I think he's going to die anyway because of that super crit. What? Crit? Oh god, this guy is leveling up bad as well, but whatever. So, one thing is true, you guys got a kill. You could have played it so differently, so very differently. What you could have done is, you could have wrapped around, instead of coming at her from the front, there's no way if this guy is even a little bit good, he stays here. The right move was to wrap around from the side, and when you're standing here, throw out a poison touch. While you're throwing out a poison touch, the CK starts coming close. She's slowed for 2 seconds. That's 2 seconds enough for CK to come in and throw down a stun. And then you do the whatever, everything you did, because she would have taken some damage. Even right now, you could have thrown out a poison touch any time right now. Okay, now she's stunned for 3 seconds, so you want to wait for 3 seconds and right now throw down a poison touch. You're late on all of those things. So, yes, it is important to stack your disables and stuns and slows and all that, but it is important to get them out. Like, you don't have to maximize the stacking. Like, you can just throw this down a bit earlier. It's not that much damage. It's level 1. It's, 42 damage? Yeah, 42 damage. Not a lot, but it is physical damage, so it is almost 42 damage. Considering this, holy shit, this guy has a lot, so it wouldn't have been 42, it's more like 20 damage. Anyway, oh, did you know Dazzle spells are physical?
Yeah.
Okay.
The heal and it is fun, everything is almost physical.
Once again, you're in the lane, you're constantly in the lane, you are using spells on the creeps, you're using heal on the creeps, so that's pushing the lane. You really don't need the heal right now, you can eat the tree for heal because you have trees, so there's no reason to be pushing out the wave. You're giving Naga lots and lots and lots of free XP. Like, we'll see after this wave. I forgot to check before. We will see after this wave how much XP she has. Alright, now the waves are even. So you have almost level 5, right? 100 XP to level 5. Sorry, 200 XP to level 5. This guy has level 5 just now. So you and this guy, you and your carry are nearly the same level. When that happens, either you've gotten a couple of kills, you've made some really good rotations, you've killed the courier or something, or you've been leeching all the XP from the carry. And look at this guy, he's more than level 5 right now. He's more higher level than your carry is. See?
I see.
So that is really, really bad. When the offlaner is getting so many levels, a solo offlaner is getting so many levels, that's really bad. And you could have avoided that simply by constantly pulling. You had the right idea at the start, but then somewhere along the line, you seemed to have forgotten that you needed a stack. You started off fine. You started off great, but then you forgot. So...
even here, I just remembered I should stack, but then it was too late.
Why are you not hitting this illusion? The illusion is doing a lot of damage to you. Like Naga's illusion, so it's level 2 illusion. It's doing 30% of Naga's damage, but it takes 500% damage, right? So 30% of her damage right now, 62, is 18, about 20 damage. So it is still doing 20 damage. 20 damage does hurt a lot to you. I'm not sure if it was doing 20 damage or more. It was doing more than 20 damage because you had a riptide on you. You had minus 4 armor. So it was doing quite more like 30 damage to you. But if you hit her twice, hit this illusion twice, it dies. So I'm not sure why you are not focusing on that. Stun. There we go. So right here, you should just get back. Good job. Eat a tree. Good job. Yeah, you just need to get out of the habit of staying so much in lane. You don't need you're playing like your carry needs a babysitter. You're playing like that there's a dual off lane and they're harassing your carry a lot, but that's not happening right now. There's a solo off laner. Your carry doesn't need constant lane support. What you should be doing is you should be constantly pulling, not just to get your own farm, but also to firstly deny the XP from the off laner. Secondly, make sure that your carry gets as much XP as possible. You know when, support is not supposed to farm the carry lane, right?
Yeah.
So it's almost the same amount of importance that you don't actually leech the XP from the carry. I'm not saying you're level 1 at 10 minutes in because you didn't leech, but you can quite easily pull the side camps and stack the camps and all that, and get all the XP you want, you need. Usually you're aiming for level 6 by 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And you can quite easily achieve that by stacking and pulling through and all that. Not sure what your carry is doing right now.
Yeah, I asked him to go back to farming just like 10 seconds ago in this game.
Yeah. Also not sure what you're doing here.
Well, I came to, because they were ganking Undying on the top rune, and I rotated mid, and then I asked for one observer from him.
No, what I meant was what you were doing over here. You were ahead of all your cores. You need to be behind all of your cores.
Actually, I was behind, but then I turned left when they were diving the tier 2, so I just scouted Sven and I was like pinging him and saying that he should get back, there's their carry rotating.
Ahead, moving forward. Your carry for some reason has left the lane. And all right, so your positioning once again. I want to go back to that previous fight just to have a better look at your positioning, overall positioning. All right, so you were here. So constantly look at where your positioning is. Right, your positioning should always be here. Never like this guy is slightly behind you. But if we unpause, yeah, bad positioning right now. Bad positioning because you're ahead. You're ahead of this guy. The only time you want to be ahead of this guy is if you're going in to use your Brave or you're going in to use your Shadow Wave. Now, what you want to do is you want to hover over your ability, just like so. And make sure you know how much your range is. And then you want to be slightly behind.
I see.
So let's say wherever you're standing, your range should be reaching about this much, right? So that all you need to do is you need to take 2 steps forward and use a grave or a wave or something, right? Just a little bit behind from your maximum range. But right now you're too far forward, right? And now you're going in for the right clicks. You don't need to do that. You don't need to do that at all. Up until this point, your movements were fine. I mean, not fine, but So that was a poor movement, and then this movement is fine. Bad movement right now, because your cores at the start you might have thought, oh, they're going for the dive, so I have to keep following them just in case I need to throw down a heal. Even though I said to you that you have to be at maximum range, so you should have been standing here, not I even see. Here. It's excusable a little bit, but still, you should have been standing here just in case they do dive. You can just take two steps forward and throw down the heal or a grave. But this right now, you're ahead of everybody, and right now you're under the tower even. Right, so this is bad movement. Usually in team fights, if it's a good team, they're going to look to kill the supports in the back line. But if the supports aren't in the back lines, then it's really, really easy to kill the supports. They're usually going to target you. If you're Dazzle and the enemy team is a good team, like good players on the enemy team, then they're going to look to target Dazzle first because he's a super squishy support. And if they can bait out the shallow grave on you, literally once you use the shallow grave on you, they will they will ignore you. They will not even right-click you to take a super easy kill. They will completely ignore you, and they will just look for the other team. And they will kill the other team, and then they will kill you. Because at that point, all you are is just 100, 120 heal. That's it. That's like useless almost.
I see. All right.
Now your movements. So, I want to... Your camera is wrong. Your camera is not aware of where your movements are. You're looking way too far ahead. It is important to look far ahead, but you should know where you're walking from and whatnot. Because you're taking this route. You're not... Once again, you're not a chaser, you're not an offlaner, you're not a carry, you're the Dazzle support, you're not even a line, you're the Dazzle support, and all you are is just a heal and a grave. The reason why a lot of people don't level up Poison Touch is exactly because of this reason, because you need to get so close to people out of position to throw this down that it's not even worth leveling this up. But because you have 8th lens now, if you get 8th lens, you actually have a lot of space to throw down Poison Touch. Regardless, not talking about that. Your positioning right now, it should have been here, behind this guy. Even that isn't a really good position, because right now this is a really, really dangerous space. Still, you have a ward here. Because you have a ward here, so you can literally be anywhere in this entire region and you're safe. As long as you see people are not coming from anywhere around, you're safe. Ward over here also means you're safe going in this direction. But I still wouldn't really recommend going in this direction. I still would have gone with this guy, behind this guy. Second thing is that you have a ward here. Wait, where's your ward? Ah, here. I think at this point you saw the Sven moving towards you as well. Like, you should have had your eye out on the minimap. As soon as you see that Sven is actually coming, so even if you are moving in this direction, as soon as you see this, Sven is actually coming in from this direction, you should have immediately backed right off and started going in this direction, right?
I see.
Moreover, you keep going, and this is, once again, you see Sven. You see Sven, and you're still, like, not afraid of him or anything like that, right? So Sven can't kill you right now, that's for sure, right? Even if he has stun and he has ulti, he can't kill you, but he can sure as hell make you panic and use Grave on you or do lots and lots of free damage to you. Which is not so
actually important. I saw Sven with the first ward, the one on the left side, and then I pinged him out. Then I had to write to the team that the Sven's coming this way, but they were already diving. So I was like, if I can keep the Sven busy enough, the Undying can get out. So that was what I was thinking.
Okay, all right, that's fine. That's a good idea then. Right here, your team is retreating, but you're the last one back. Oh, this is probably where you were writing or something?
Yeah. This is where I was asking RCK to go out far.
Probably use voice chat much, much better, because right now you're in a horrible position. You're the last one back. That's not something that Dazzle wants to be. And also, you waited to use heal on this guy. You could have been caught out by this guy's net. I'm not sure why he didn't use net. He should have precasted the net, because he didn't even have net. If he had had net, you were dead there.
Yeah.
Pretty sure you were dead there. Yeah, you were guaranteed actually dead there. I think he had net, he just didn't level it up yet. He also had leveled up, but he didn't actually click to level it up, so you're lucky there. Anyway, moving forward. Yeah, and this fight happens. Oh wait, no, I didn't see this fight. I thought this was the...
Yeah, this is the most out of position I ever get. This is the worst fight I had.
Alright, once again, you're right-clicking creeps. You need to disable your auto-attacks as a support, as most supports, because you're not going to use auto-attacks.
They are disabled.
No. What I mean is, like, literally.
Don't tell that, take it off.
Yeah, you're not gonna take right. You're not gonna do right click. The only time you're gonna do right clicks is if nobody's in the lane and you're like taking creeps or something. All right, you graved the guy who wasn't even close to dying and who's not even a core. Right, you don't need to grave this guy at all. You need to. Okay, the second thing, you need to save grave for important targets. Even if the Undying is about to die, you do not grave him. Even if the Clockwork is about to die, you do not grave him. You save the grave for Dazzle. Sorry, it's for this guy. What's his name?
Weaver.
For Weaver. And you save the grave for the CK. That's the only time you want to be graving. This is team fights. I'm not talking about some skirmishes where you're just next to one person and you don't grave him, obviously. But right here, you really, really should have graved this guy instead.
Well, in fact, I was expecting the Queen of Pain to actually ult the Undying. So I was saying, okay, it's a 135 second cooldown and it's better not to get a kill with it. So that was my mindset there. Then again, another time in middle lane, the same thing happens and I just grave the Undying 1 second, almost a half second before the Queen of Pain ult. So
let's look at this fight in a very different light, right? Let's say you were in the correct position, which was around here, right?
Mm-hmm.
That way, the Queen of Pain actually doesn't even know where Dazzle is. That way, when she actually blinks forward, she's not going to try to go for the double ult. The only reason why she threw it out on you guys is because she saw two people here and one person here. So she was like, I'm going to go for the double ult. So if your position had been around here, then Cop wouldn't have ulted this direction. And then what would have happened is this guy would have died, actually. This guy would have died guaranteed because Cop would have ulted him. But then I don't think you would have been able to grave him. Let's see how much HP he has. He has 361, 225 damage at level... 290 damage, right? 290 damage at level 1. Scream of Pain plus ulti. Yeah, this guy is pretty much dead. There's almost no way you save him. But at least... in that case, at least this guy would have been full HP. Maybe he does damage to Co-op. He's still dead.
Yeah.
Right. So in that case, only one person would have died instead of two. Weaver would have been full HP, and he would have been actually been very, very good.
Yeah, the 2K MMR, like.
And as I said, Weaver would have been full HP. He wouldn't have died here. He would have killed this guy. Cop doesn't have mana for Blink. Cop doesn't have Blink anyway. I think he would have gotten two kills here. So right here, instead of three people dying, one person would have died. That is, the Undying only would have died. And secondly, you would have had Heal. You would have had Grave. Weaver wouldn't have died here. Weaver would have been full HP from that engagement. And he still would have been clipped from this Riptide, but at least he would have been maybe, you know, two-thirds of his HP. He would have killed the Naga, and he possibly could have killed the Co-op as well. So, poor positioning from you, and poor play from Weaver combined resulted in three kills instead of just one. Actually, there's a chance that if they'd killed Undying there and you came out from the back, they might not have even gone on Weaver. Anyway, regardless, your positioning was bad, and that was the main point. I'm not going to talk about what your team should have done or what they want. So, once again, look at your positioning. Very aggressive, very forward. Too far forward. There's no enemies there, but your carry is the one who should be farming, and instead you're the one who's there taking the last hits and stuff, so...
I
also,
see.
At this point in the game, you kind of laning his stage is over. Now you need to stay with your course. So you should have been top right now. Being here with the CK, once again, you're stealing his XP. You are you're stealing his XP, and that's all you're achieving in this lane, right? So what you should have been doing right now is you should have been in the off lane with your teammates. Now, also note that it's 12 minutes in, you're still level 5. Even though you stole lots of XP from the CK, you're still level 5 because you weren't utilizing the map properly. So you were like 4-manning, 5-manning, like 3-manning all the time over here. You weren't getting any XP instead. So with Dazzle not being level 6, not a huge deal at all. It's really doesn't matter, right? Dazzle is just a heal, really. Ulti isn't super good. It is going to be extremely good against Sven, but at the moment, it's whatever, right? But instead, if you were top, let's look at what the Weaver is doing. If you were top, you could have thrown out several heals. You could have given them some more support up top, like 3v3 situation. If you'd had ulti, there's a high chance that you guys are able to kill these guys really, really quickly, etc., etc. So you could have been able to save this guy right here, which you...
I do save him, yeah.
You TP in to do that, which is really good. Good job on that. You've been very active with the TPs, but you should have been there from the very beginning. You shouldn't have had the TP there. Oh, Grave. Good Grave. Excellent Grave, actually. But he is still dead, guaranteed.
Yeah.
Nice Enigma kill. Another heal. You don't have any mana. If you hadn't TP'd there, if you were there from the beginning, you probably would have had full mana. Also, you don't have stick. You should have had stick. Almost every single support needs a stick. You need stick before you get mana boots. You get brown boots and then a stick. Always. Also, there are 4 wards in the... there's 2 wards. Where's the other 2? Oops, who bought the 2 wards? There's 3 wards on them. Okay, so somebody's been buying wards and placing them. So you just bought 2 more wards. That's good. And now you buy stick. So if you'd had stick in that previous engagement... there is a small possibility that this guy would have stayed alive because he would have had mana to use stick. Also, obviously, if you'd been top with your allies from the start, instead of TPing in, instead of using 75 mana for the TP, that could have been 75 extra mana. You were lacking 75-ish mana, less than 75 mana for your heal, by the way. I think you were lacking like 20-30 mana for your heal, so 2 charges of stick or not TPing in would have... All right. So you place a ward. It's a pretty decent ward, actually. It's a very, very high-level ward, actually.
Well, I just did it. I never saw anything like that before, but it's like, okay, that's a good place to put it for this situation.
Yeah, that's a good ward.
I really didn't expect our Weaver to just, you know, he was really active with his ult. He constantly used it, and I was like, okay, I know it's 35 second cooldown, but if you want to use it all over again,
let me just ask you one. I've rarely will you ever see a Dazzle get black holed. Rarely, simply because he's usually way, way far back. But rarely do supports get black hole, but Dazzle in particular, you could have been just as effective standing over here, right?
Yeah.
And you tell the Weaver, like, dude, plus Weaver has ult. You don't need to grave him. He has ult. You really, really didn't need to be there. So if you'd been back here, you wouldn't have gotten grave. You would have healed these guys. You would have been able to save Weaver. Actually, I think that most likely Enigma doesn't even go for the black hole, and this silly play doesn't happen if you were there. But because you were there, now Enigma is like, oh, 2 people, I'm going to go throw the black hole right now. Because Weaver was full HP, literally full HP.
Yeah.
And even if he does throw the black hole, it's literally just a Weaver. So you can black hole him, so you can grave him. It's just one person. So, and then Weaver escapes because he has invis. So it was literally your positioning once again. Your positioning once again. That is the reason for this death as well.
Yeah.
for this whole massive. Alright. Moving forward. Alright, now you've got right items, you've got a stick, you've got some wards, you've got a... you got that. You know this guy doesn't have a black hole. You should have communicated that with your... you should have communicated that to your CK. That this guy does not have black hole. He guarantees doesn't have black hole. You need to know what the cooldown of these massive, massive... big teamfight spells are. Enigma's black hole is 200 second cooldown, which is 3 minutes and 20 seconds, right? So I'm not saying look at the time when Enigma black holes, that's like 4K stuff, right? But you definitely should have a good estimation. Like, this guy just used black hole not low more than a minute ago. You should tell this guy, dude, he just used black hole. Literally pop your ult and kill him. Immediately pop your ult and kill him and hope for a triple phantasm and literally just kill him. You guys definitely, what do you call it, missed a kill there. Also, if this guy was paying attention, he would have known he doesn't, Enigma doesn't have ulti. So Enigma is literally a non-factor. He would have thrown the stun on Kop and then Kop would have died. Second thing, you're about to go out of position super, super bad. There is no reason for a Dazzle with his cores being full HP to move in this direction right now. You should go, actually, once, especially when you see somebody coming in, you should literally start running away immediately. Mm-hmm. Because most likely they're going to go on you. Because if they kill you, no grave, no heal, no nothing. Right? You're lucky you escaped that positioning, and now once again you're going too far forward. Right? That heal wasn't required at all. You literally just stole that kill right there.
Well, I just wanted to make sure that Naga doesn't ult, because I felt like she's getting ready for that.
You don't have a TP either. Like, Grave TP, there's only, like, stuns that can save you, prevent that. So
actually, from my experience in this MMR, like, when they see you Grave and that they can't do any damage, they sometimes panic and just leave you alone. Like, that has happened to me.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with that. I agree with that one. Alright, so a lot of lucky stuff just happened, to be honest.
Yeah, he just set up a kill for us. Like, literally set up.
I'm not sure how you are still alive, but you are. So that's good. Now you're gonna escape, and what are you gonna buy? You are gonna buy a medallion?
Because the 5 armor reduction, I felt like we need kind of more armor because of the Naga armor reduction.
I think it would, you're not that kind of hero. You're not that utility hero. You really needed, you need Aether Lens, you need, so make a decision between Aether Lens or mech. If you're getting lots of farm, make mech. If your team needs a mech, if your team's going to be a pushing lineup and there's no other mech carrier, make a mech. Right now, there's nobody in your team who's going to make a mech. I think you should have gone for a mech. You're going to get mech pretty late, but you should still have gone for a mech. You can go for Aether Lens as well before mech, but that's usually when you either don't have a pushing lineup or somebody else is going to make mech, or you feel like, yeah, we don't really need a mech. But I think especially because of CK, firstly because of CK, secondly because of Queen of Pain's ulti. Queen of Pain ults, you pop mech, it's like almost like taking no damage from Kop. Almost. Yeah. Right? She still does tons of damage. At level 1 is taking no damage at all. At level 2 is taking only like 100 damage. But it's 380. So you're doing 250. So it's 180. Level 1 nuke. Level 2 nuke. Yeah. So it's almost like not taking any damage. So yeah, mech, really, really good. Really, really important. And if you feel like no mech, then go for Aether Lens. You've already got this Arcane Boots. So you can go for Aether Lens. And if you're going to go mech, then you go Brown Boots. Brown Boots first, then complete mech, because it's going to take a long time. You go for a mech, and then you... well, that's situational, actually. Depends on how fast you need mech and how slow you think your farm is going to be. Then you get lots of clarities. You constantly keep getting clarities. and then you complete your mech. Once again, you're not with your team. This literally would not have happened if you'd been with your team. I was talking about mech, so I didn't get a chance to talk about what you were doing here. Once again, you're farming. You're right-clicking creeps. You shouldn't be right-clicking creeps. You should be out of vision. Dazzle needs to be out of vision. You need to tell the enemy team that, hey, I'm not even here. The reason why you need to be out of position, there are two reasons why you need to be out of position. Firstly, so the enemy thinks Dazzle isn't here. Obviously, a good player will know Dazzle is behind the team. Second reason, the most important, the 90% of the reason why you need to be out of vision is so that enemy team can't actually go and jump you and kill you.
I see.
There's a Sven, he ulties, blinks, stuns you, kills you in one hit. There's a cop, she blinks in the back, she kills you, she orchids you, she kills you, whatever. There's an Earthshaker, he throws down the stun, then the enemy team initiates. There's like so many things that they can do to make sure you don't get your grave off or make sure that you die. So you really, really need to be out of vision. Throw down the heal the targets closest to you. Even if you want to heal somebody much forward, target the person closest to you so that the heal can travel in the you know, connecting chain. You see your Weaver here. Either go with your Weaver or go with the CK. What you are doing, you are almost going with the CK, and then for some reason you turn. But then you're still going with the CK, which is great. And now you turn again. Not sure why you turned here. You're not with the Weaver. You're not with the CK. CK is making a really bad play right now, right? And the creep wave is over here. This is the most retarded thing, right? The point of Dota is not to get kills. The point of Dota
I did tell them that even if we're going to five man, we better take the tier one tower mid. Because we aren't accomplishing anything like
the
this.
The right move would have been for the CK and the clock to be here taking the mid tower. The clock should have been standing around here or here or somewhere preparing for the hook or onto the person who TPs into this lane or somebody in vision, and then CK could have phantasm and killed that person, and then you guys could have taken this tower. But instead, these guys are making a ridiculous move. However, even if your cores are making a stupid decision, stupid move, your job is to make sure they stay alive making that stupid decision. Your job is to stick behind them, stay behind them, tell them this is a bad job, don't go there, get back. But if they still decide to go forward, then you need to be here. You could have graved this guy right now. You could have healed these guys right now, and they wouldn't have died. This guy would have died. Probably Cop would have died as well. Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. Definitely your people wouldn't have died, and Sven definitely would have died.
True.
And this engagement could have been completely different. And then maybe you guys could have taken top tower out. Nah, there's no way you take top tower after that because the wave is so pushed in. But at least you guys don't die. Your guys don't die. And right here as well, you were almost, I think you were in base. Not sure why you were in base. Just stick with one of your cores. The bigger carry, the better carry. The more farmed carry. Right? So right now, Weaver's got 2 kills, 3 deaths. CK's got 2 kills, 1 death. CK is higher net worth, so you and Weaver is much, much lower net worth. So you really, really needed to stick with the CK. Bad item choices all around. Literally, why would you go for an SNY when you're a CK? You need the Manta. You're already going to go for a Yasha. So.
And our clockwork, I kept telling him that you should build a blade mail for yourself, but he wanted to go for an assault crest, and I was like, okay, but the E from the Naga just nullifies whatever you give us. Like, what's the point of it? That way you're paying 4,000 golds for an item that he can just disable it for you.
Yeah. All right here, once again, your positioning here should be around over here, maybe even farther back, because you want to, as we said, their vision is, I think it's up to here, or up to here, something like here. So you want to be, you know, over here. Make sure that they don't see you. Instead, you're right there underneath the tower. Anybody can blink on you and kill you immediately. And obviously they know exactly where you are. That's the bigger issue. don't care, but you still didn't get the tower, right? You're a support. How are you gonna get the tower? There's a Earthshaker. He's put like 400 times your damage. Literally 400 times your damage. If he's got that level, yeah, he's got 400 times. You guys are gonna have about the same damage, right? So 77, and you've got about the same. So he's literally got 400 times damage. Four hundred percent, I meant.
Yeah.
Alright. Why am I looking at the wrong person? Where did you die?
Yeah, I died top after the clock's hook.
Alright. Once again, you're with your clock, you're not with your CK, you're not with your Weaver. And at this point, you shouldn't even be with your Weaver, you should just be with your CK. So once again, you died because you were with the wrong person. And also, I think Clock wouldn't have made that move if you weren't with him. Like, he would have been like, oh yeah, okay, I'm alone, so I probably shouldn't do this. Alright. So apart from your poor positioning, good decision to be with the CK. And Grave, perfect, everything perfect. So you did everything, and then you do, and then you Grave him, you heal him, you move back, perfect play. This is what you need to be doing. The only mistake you made in this engagement, literally the only mistake you made in this engagement, is that you were too far forward in the beginning. That's it.
I see.
And this is the second mistake you made, which is pretty much to not run away, and instead you stand there. And if you wanted to get rid of this illusion, okay, I was about to say Grave it, like throw down a shadow wave, but you throw down a shadow wave right here.
Yeah,
there's five creeps, there's six creeps. This guy would have died, this illusion would have died immediately. Instead, you decide to throw down a heal and do zero
damage. I failed it.
And so you should have been like, even now, if you kept running, maybe go into the trees, I think you weren't looking at your minimap for sure. Because I'm not sure why you allowed yourself to die like that. So, but that engagement, that was good play. You threw down a Grave, you threw down a heal, and then you saw that you have nothing left. You move back. And you move back, you stay back until you have some other spell coming off cooldown, and then go move forward again. Obviously, at the same time, assessing if the carry is about to die. If the carry is about to die, you run away, because otherwise you're going to die as well. Right? So try playing this way. Try playing like you've got a gem. From level 1, you've got a gem. And you don't want to give that gem away. So that's how you should be playing. Because Dazzle is zero aggression hero. Literally zero. You don't need to throw down heals offensively to get damage in. That's not your job.
I see.
Yeah, I think we can end the replay here.
Yeah.
Because your main issue, and you know, this is a really easy thing to fix as well, positioning. It just takes a little bit of practice. But next time, all the points that I've written down for you, obviously have a read through them. But the next 3, 4, 5, 6, whatever games that you play, only have one thing in mind. Do whatever you want, but only have one thing in your mind, positioning. You need to have defensive positioning, play behind your heroes, and try to stick only with your strongest core and save him, throw down heals, throw down whatever. Same goes for playing Omni Knight. Very same playstyle, very same positioning thing. You stay slightly back. Omni is slightly different because you do need to get a bit forward to use your ultimate because it's a really, really small AoE. But other than that, you are mostly just staying really far back and throwing down heals. So,